Hi guys, thank you for joining us for Final Fantasy at the North Texas Teen Book Festival online. My name is Sydnie Shreffler. I'm a volunteer with North Texas Teen Book Festival 4 or 5 years now, so that's been fun. I'm really excited to see how this goes online and see all these wonderful authors and the amazing books that they've written. I would like you guys to introduce yourselves. If you could just say your name, the book that you are going to be talking about today, and let's go with favorite donut flavor. Mine's cake donut, by the way.
Mine too. Nobody else
really
likes those.
Same. Everyone thinks I'm so boring. I'm like, they're so good. Okay, so why don't you go?
Yeah, I'll start. Hi, guys. My name is Jordan Ifueko. I wrote the New York Times bestselling book, Raybearer, and its sequel is coming out this summer, Redemptor. Raybearer is the story of a magically hewn Pangaea kingdom, or empire, ruled by an emperor who is said to be almost divine, because for every person he anoints to his council of 11, he becomes immune to one death. The catch is that anyone he anoints still has the ability to murder him. And so our protagonist is a young girl sent to the capital as a plant to kill the future emperor by assimilating into his council. It's a mix of lots of different cultures, but also heavily inspired by Yoruba culture, which is the background of my immigrant family. And my favorite donut is probably a blueberry cake donut. I think I grew up eating them because in Nigeria, I grew up here, but my parents grew up there, and their kind of donuts, they're all like really cakey, like they like really dense cakes. So those are delicious.
Awesome. Megan, why don't you go next?
Okay. Well, I'm just going to start by saying cake donuts are the best donuts. That cinnamon sugar cake donuts are the best of all donuts. Just personal favorite. And that probably has a lot to do with the fact that my family, a large part of it, lived in Pennsylvania with the Pennsylvania Dutch, who really commit to their donuts. So yeah, I grew up liking the cake donuts, especially fresh, hot cake donuts. In 1997, my first novel, The Thief, was a Newbery Honor book. I've been working on that series ever since. And after 25 years later, I have published on October 6th, The Return of the Thief, which is the sixth book in the series and wraps up a narrative of an extremely enterprising, audacious, and sometimes obnoxious young thief in a peninsula of three countries, Aetolia, Sunnis, and Edis, who are not particularly interested in uniting, but who all of whom are under threat of invasion from a much larger empire and a coalition of states on their other border. So it's been a long time getting here, and I'm really happy to be done with the book, to be able to offer the book to you, and to be here at the North Texas Teen Book Festival.
Awesome. Hafsah, how about you?
Hello, I am Hafsah Faizal, and I am the author of We Hunt the Flame, and it's just released sequel, We Free the Stars. And so We Hunt the Flame is my debut fantasy, young adult fantasy. It's set in a world inspired by ancient Arabia, where a girl named Zafira ventures to this villainous island where she has to retrieve a lost artifact that can save her dying world. And at the same time, we have the Prince of Death, who is an assassin sent on a similar mission to find her, kill her off, and steal the artifact for his father, the autocratic Sultan. But when their paths cross on the island, that's not exactly what happens. And they discover an ancient evil brewing that they might have to join forces to defeat. It was going to be my last attempt at publication. And so I incorporated all of my favorite tropes into there. And the fantasy setting is just my favorite part. As for my favorite donut, nothing beats a cake donut and nothing beats a hot glazed donut. But I think I like the French crouler I'm not sure why, but I really enjoy that one.
That's fair.
Okay, yep, that's a wonderful donut too. It's true.
Darcie. I can hear your judgment.
Darcie, how about you?
Oh, hello everyone. I'm Darcie Little Badger, and I have a PhD in oceanography, but I'm also a writer, and my debut novel, Alatsoe, was published this August 2020. And it's a fantasy mystery story about a teenage girl named Ellie, short for Alatsoe, which is actually the name of my grandmother. I just have to put that out there. It means hummingbird in the Lipan language. But she lives in a world that's very similar to ours. You know, it's contemporary times, but there are a few exceptions to that. For example, there's fairy rings that can transport people from one end of the world to the other almost instantaneously. There's monsters, there's curses. And Ellie herself has the ability to wake up the ghosts of animals. These include animals like her ghost dog, Kirby, but also prehistoric animals like woolly mammoths. And really, Ellie is just trying to enjoy her summer when her beloved cousin dies. And she learns that he was murdered in a way that was set up to resemble an accident. And he was murdered by this wealthy, well-established doctor. So that she knows right off the bat, this isn't a whodunit, but it's why would this person murder her cousin? And what's going on with the really creepy town that this guy lives in? So she ends up investigating with the help of her friends and her family. And just it becomes this kind of deep well of darkness and conspiracies in a creepy South Texas town that doesn't exist in real life. People have asked me if Willoughby is a real place. And then I know, no, it's not. But of course, it could be out there. And in terms of my favorite donut, I really like maple glazed donut. And I'm sorry, I can't stand cake donuts. They just remind me too much of cake. And I'm like, no, if I want a cake, I'm gonna eat a cake. I like the little squishy donuts. So I really apologize. Like, everyone's donut tastes are entirely valid. So you do you.
I apologize, you're fine.
All right, that's good.
There's just something super classic and amazing about it. Like a cake donut.
I'm just glad we can all agree on donuts.
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, donuts.
Yeah. Okay, so let's get started. First off, Jordan, Darcie, congratulations on your debut year. I know that 2020 looked a little strange for a debut year, probably. What was it like navigating this really exciting moment in your career and in your life at the same time as like dealing with the pandemic? Did you have to come up with new ways to promote your book and just get yourself out there?
I'm gonna say I was one of the lucky ones in that my publisher agreed to move my book to the summer and the pandemic was still going on, but I was honestly so upset at how many of like my debut siblings, like we were all getting ready to come out together, you know, in the springtime, some earlier. And these people who wrote these beautiful stories, like their publishers were just like, well, no, we can't move all of them. So you guys are just gonna have to like take the hit and come out when like all of the tours are canceled and none of us have any like big replacement systems yet. Yeah. Because by the time I came out, even though it was still stressful, people were used to, you know, online events all of a sudden. We'd had festivals online, all that stuff. So when everything hit, honestly, I'd spent a long time trying to scramble to make sure all of these books, especially these new fantasies from writers of color, got some semblance of a, yeah, we just kind of all grouped together. It's just like, we'll be your tour. And it did work, it was great. But by the time mine rolled around, there was so much anxiety with everything going on. Like that was like also when all of the Black Lives Matter protests were surging and my husband and I were out protesting in the streets and things were on fire. And it was, I don't know. I don't want to be dramatic, but a lot of that period, even though it was technically like the peak of my career, like I got published and it made the list and stuff, it kind of like, there's a lot of blank spots. Like I was just under a lot of pressure and I just kind of look back on it. And what I remember isn't, you know, the celebrations and the virtual cool stuff, but just like the individual messages I would sometimes get. Well, I got a lot during that period from teenagers who got to read the book. Those are what I'm gonna get emotional about it, but those are what just yeah, made it seem real to me. Like my book is in the hands of other people and also in people that I, you know, feel like I used to be, like teenagers who would just really wanted a fairy tale to get lost in. So that's what it was like for me. And luckily that's something that's still happening, right? Is that people are still reading the book and enjoying it. So I think it's good that I didn't get too attached to the whole like, ah, getting so much attention. It's my release month. But also it was harrowing. So that was me.
How has it been for the past year? Like,
yeah, I've got to get a little bit serious here. So the month after I sold Alaskaway, this was, I believe, the end of 2018, my father was diagnosed with terminal cancer called mesothelioma, caused by often exposure to asbestos, maybe continually. Now, he was an English professor, the head of the Department of Writing, but to pay for college when he was a young man, he did do things like work in a steel mill or, you know, asbestos concrete pipes. He'd cut them for this, for in Texas, you know, for the city. So really, I haven't really been too excited as much about debuting as I have been concerned about my family. Of course, in 2020, shortly before Alaskaway was published, my father died. He died in the middle of this pandemic. So for many months, like I've got to say that there's been some horrific things. People with COVID-19 have been terribly affected by this overwhelmed health system, but so have other people with these very serious conditions such as cancer. So it was a struggle to be with him because, you know, the health system was overwhelmed. And at certain times, you know, they were blocking us from being with him. He was unfortunately not getting the attention he needed because people were so overwhelmed. So that was my life, like right up to when Alaskaway was published. But I have to say, Levine Carrito, my publisher, I emailed them and I said, we don't have much longer. As you read in the acknowledgments of Alaskaway, he was really the driving force behind like teaching me how to be a writer. You know, I wrote my first book when I was in first grade. And I was like 7 years old. It was like this 40-page mystery about a murdered garden. And I kind of described this acknowledgments, but my father, who was a student at the time, he took the time to like edit all of these very grammatically incorrect sentences, teach me what those edits meant, and then even taught me how to write a query letter. And so we sent out this book and I got a very polite rejection from the publisher, but he framed that because he told me someday you're gonna look back and see how far you've come. So my publisher did send a copy of Alaskaway, I'd say, so that was the summer. It was published in August. So it was a couple of months before the publication date. And he got to look at it and it was like one of the last times he smiled. So it's been one thing though is, during all of this, it's been rough, but after his death, a group of science fiction, fantasy, LGBTQ writers got together and made a donation in his name to the Carl Brandon Society. And I have to say, we couldn't have a funeral. You know, this is a beautiful man. He was very loving and intelligent and accepting. So it was just wonderful that this online community of writers and readers have been so supportive. Even if it's virtual, you know, it's important, you know, to me, that he was receiving this recognition and that Alaskaway has received so much positive recognition because I know that he would be happy. So that's been my debut year. It's been a rough one, but you know, it's been rough for so many people in so many ways. People are suffering, but I also have experienced the great strength of community.
Awesome. Well, it's so beautiful. I was not ready for that story at all. That's so beautiful.
Oh no. I'm sorry for springing it on everyone.
No, it was so good. Thank you for sharing. No,
it's nothing. It's not even about springing it on anyone. It's an encouraging story that people need to hear. And your dad's when you were 7.
Yeah. Oh boy, that was not the. I you know, back then I could barely spell. I have to say I was 7 years old, so it was a great feat for him as an English student to sit through all that. Oh, but he loved me.
That's awesome. So I guess on the flip side of a career, or in the middle of your career, Hafsah, this is your sophomore book. Megan, it's been over 20 years since The Thief was first published. Hafsah, I know the last time we spoke, you were nervous about writing We Free the Stars. How did it go? How do you feel? What's it like? What was it like to go back to the world of Araldia? Am I saying that right?
Yeah, it's Araldia. So yeah, the sequel, well, you hear from a lot of authors that writing sequels are hard. It's a hard thing to do. And I understood that, and I paid attention, I listened to everyone, and then I started writing my sequel. And it basically broke me. I started writing it, and then with We Hunt the Flame, it was the first time I went on tour. I was a very introverted person, suddenly thrust out there into like all of these events, and then now it feels like I'm complaining, but at the time it was like every couple weeks I was on a plane and visiting some new state to do an event, and I loved every minute of it, but at the same time I was not prepared to like come back to my hotel room and be able to write. I could not get back into my like headspace to do that. And it's also the fact that you're writing for an audience for the first time. You know that there are readers at the end of this. You know, you're just not trying to please an agent anymore. You're trying to please all of these people. And so it was really hard for me to silence those voices. And so we kept pushing the release date back. Like We Free the Stars was supposed to release in May of 2020. And then it pushed over to July 2020, then September. And then it came out last month in January. And so it was, yeah, it was just, I told myself that I would not be writing anymore. Like, this is it. I could not form words anymore. Like, I couldn't speak. Like, it was just, I don't know what happened to me, but it was impossible and it was terrible and I wouldn't wish it on anyone. But I finally like I wasn't very pleased with the book either, but now that it's out there and it's connecting with the readers who loved Beyond the Flame, I feel a lot, happier with it, a lot prouder of it because of what I went through to get that out there. So
it's a beautiful story, just so you know. Thank you. I loved the end. It killed me a little bit. It broke me a little bit. But I was like, oh, okay. But it is a great story. Megan, how are you feeling? What is it like to go 20 years and hit the end of a series, to come back to that? I mean, there's like a what, like a 10-year break in there somewhere?
I think those books came out, the biggest break was about 6 years.
Okay, great. I don't math so well, so you're good.
Maybe seven. Anyway, I just turn them out like clockwork every six or seven or something like that years. And you know, it, I don't know if it's because it's the end of all of these years of work and if I would feel this way anyway, but it's very surreal. Mm. It's just, with the pandemic, I don't know what I feel anymore about anything really. Mm-hmm. And so I don't know, maybe I would feel exactly the same way if there were no pandemic, maybe I would still be feeling sort of bewildered. But I know some people, they get to the end of their series and they experience a real sense of loss, that, you know, they're done with those characters. And I'm not feeling that at all. I think that's partly because I don't feel like finishing up this narrative arc necessarily means I'm done with that world or with that characters. I think I'll be talking to the people in my head for another 25 years. And I just want to go back to Darcie's point. And Darcie, I'm so sorry about your loss.
Oh, thank you.
But what you said about the Carl Brandon Society, one of the weird silver linings of the pandemic, after writing all of these books for all of these years and corresponding with people all over the world about them, and getting messages from people saying, is there any chance that you're ever going to be in Oklahoma? Will you ever come to Nebraska? Do you think that you would come to see it? Will you travel abroad ever? And my answer is that usually if I'm traveling someplace, I'm happy to set up small signings any place I go that people are interested in coming out and having a cup of coffee with me. But the chance that my publisher is ever going to send me, that there's going to ever be like a book launch event that all of these people or many of these people could attend is just vanishingly small. But having the book launch online meant all of my fans, all of my readers, all kinds of people who've been reading these books for 25 years, who'd literally like grown up and had children, they could all come. So the book launch was just tremendous. It was one huge worldwide party for me. It was wonderful.
It just changed the accessibility.
Yeah. And I hope that even after the pandemic, we will continue to have this sense of online community, that people can get together for the North Texas Teen Book Festival or a book launch or something like that and feel like the authors are right there and accessible. Mm-hmm. You know, that you can type your little question into a chat and the author might answer it. I think that's something we shouldn't let go of once we can all get back in person.
Yeah. Well, Hafsah, that brings me to Ian's question from Jasper High School. He wants to know, how does it feel to end a series that you spent so long building the world and investing in those characters?
It feels, well, it made me sad. I mean, every time I edited the last few chapters of We Feed the Stars, I cried. And it was difficult because I have to like make sure my family doesn't see me crying over these fictional people. But the thing is, We Hunt the Flame is the first book, We Feed the Stars is the second book. So it felt like I just started my journey with these people, and then suddenly I was having to wrap up everything and tie it all off. But I did leave a few threads hanging for whenever my editor is like, yeah, okay, you can get back to work on that, and so that I can revisit the story and the world, because I'm not ready to say goodbye. But also my new duology, A Tempest of Tea, it is set in a universe that's expanding from Arawia, and it's still the same world of We Hunt the Flame, different characters, different story, but a little piece of that carries on, and that makes me happy. But yeah, it feels like Megan said, it's surreal, but also just emotional, and it feels like I'm not ready to say goodbye yet.
Well, I guess I'll build on that. This question is for Jordan and Darcie. Hafsah, you were just talking about building out the world that you've created. So I guess I'll ask Jordan and Darcie, how do you go about researching a fantasy world that is significantly based on your own culture? And Hafsah, you know, We Hunt the Flame and We Fear the Stars are based on your culture as well. But my question is, who or what are your resources that you lean on the most? And that question came from Isabella of Sewagon High. She asked, how much of your inspiration is taken from real life and how much is fictional?
So for mine, I started Raybearer when I was 13. So almost 15 years ago. And I lived in a very white small town in Oregon. And so when I first started this story, even though I already knew even at that age that I didn't want to write a Eurocentric fantasy, that wasn't one I could write a heroine I could see myself in, but I hadn't ever seen an Afrocentric fantasy. And so I didn't feel like I had permission to write that. I had no pattern. And so at first I just made it super vague. Like all of the characters had this kind of like just brownish skin and like Afro-Latin-y names, and just nothing was ever too specific, and it was a hot mess. But you know, that's what got me started, right? And then in college, I just kind of just woke up and was like, why can't I just make this specific? So then I went to like the other extreme almost. It middled a little bit, the final product years and years later, but all of the cultures are very specifically coded on specific people groups. You know, there's the Yoruba, there's the Shona people, there's the Han Chinese, there's the, you know, very specific era, Joseon period, Korea, like all of these different places. And weirdly, the hardest place to research was my own background, because while there is lots of academic sources on pre-colonial West Africa, a lot of the ones that are accessible are ones written by colonizers who didn't understand what they were seeing, or saw it, or described it with absolute condescension. And I still had to make use of those. I would just like basically take away their filter and be like, okay, what are the words of the song they're seeing? Like, at least you saw something and you wrote it down and your interpretation is stupid, but at least I know what happened and I can go ask my parents, like, hey, what do you think this is? And they'll be like, oh, that sounds like this ritual, you know, just like that kind of thing. So it was a lot of work. At one point I literally had like a subscription to JSTOR. I was like desperately emailing these like old professors in Lagos, like, can I just have a copy of your article, please? There's just a paywall and I need, you know, just like all of these things, just because once I started, I really wanted to bring this place to life. It felt like I was excavating something that I hadn't gotten to see as a kid, this place of my ancestors that was beautiful and at that point untouched mm-hmm. by colonization. These beautiful kingdoms, they were enormous. The Oyo Empire of the Benin, you know, the Yoruba Empire, and these complicated trade routes and beautiful cities and castles, and it was just gorgeous. And so that took a lot of work. I think maybe all of my relatives were a little, I think they were touched, but also surprised at how excited I got when they'd let even a little thing slip that I hadn't heard about Nigeria before. Like, oh yeah, and we used to play this game and it went like this and it was really silly. And like that game would make it into the book. Like at one point there's a game where all of the children are dancing and it's this really goofy, fun dance. They're like, everybody do as I do, don't laugh as I do. And they're just doing like the worst ridiculous dances they can think of. And whoever laughs first loses the game. So the emperor joins these children and plays this game. And it's just, it's a very small thing, but even just getting tiny bits of culture like that would just make my entire week. So that was my process. It was very personal, but also in many ways, very academic and sterile of just trying to get things right. And I think that authors from demographics that haven't been represented in fantasy before are under a lot of unfair pressure, because if they do get things wrong, since they're one of the only people representing this group in this genre, they get piled on. Like, that's not what we sound like in Zimbabwe, or that thing wasn't available in Zimbabwe. And I know it's not Zimbabwe, it's a fantasy coded on Zimbabwe, but it's still representing me. And so you have to get this right. And so it was incredibly stressful, but also really worth it when I did get things right. I've gotten some letters from South Korean readers who didn't expect, understandably, that there would be like a significant South Korean culture in this book, because it's marketed as like a West African fantasy and has like a black girl on the cover. And just seeing even little things like, you know, the way their houses are heated represented. She's like, they were just so delighted that even that little tiny like corner of representation was there. Yeah. And done well. And so it's really worth it. But yes, it is a lot of work.
Darcie, what about you? What did it look like to kind of fold in some of the myth culture?
Yeah, and I have to talk a little bit about the next YA book that's going to be published, because it's even more so the case in this one. My next book is called A Snake Falls to Earth. And in this one, I decided, you know what, I'm just going to forget about conventions. I'm going to base this book on Lipan Apache specific storytelling themes and structures. So it's just very much influenced by this, my culture. And that's the thing, when my greatest source of inspiration when it comes to the Lipan content in my books is really just how I was raised. I'm fortunate in that my mother, you know, she's like the director of policy for our tribe, but also I come from a family where, for example, my great grandmother was it was very important to her to make sure that she passed down our cultural like heritage, and not just her. Like, if I go back down my family tree, there's a whole bunch of just really people who took on a almost leadership position during the turmoil of the late 1800s, early 1900s. Like, if you get into it, into the geopolitical situation for the Lipan people in the late 1800s, both Mexico and the United States were trying to massacre us. So it was very tumultuous. And I am just so fortunate that I was raised to know my culture. But that's also a reason why it would take so much research. For example, if I wanted to write, my fiance is Navajo. If I wanted to write a book like a Lhasa'we, except with a Navajo main character. Now that would be a whole other thing, because even though, you know, Navajo and Apache people, we're basically sister groups, there's so many differences just talking with T. For example, even the way we think about coyote is majorly different. So I am careful. I really, because I don't want to do that research, and really there's not a lot of Lipan representation out there. So to me, it's important just to focus on my culture. But also I find that having this very intimate knowledge about my culture means that I'm able to determine what I should be putting in fantasy books based on the guidance of my mother, you know, my uncles, my aunts, the tribal council even. For example, in A Snake Falls to Earth, one of the themes, I'm not going to talk too much because it hasn't been released yet, but there is this story that starts out very mysterious, because it was spoken in a Lipan language. So the main character, a teenage girl, has this story and she can't interpret it because a lot of our language has holes in it. And actually I based that experience on something personal to my family. So my great, great grandfather, he would say something and it was a very important ceremony to him. So I won't actually go into the content, but it was so important. It was passed down, you know, to his children and their children. But at the same time, the Lipan language was being slowly, you know, lost. People weren't speaking it fluently. So it came to the point where my grandmother would say these words without necessarily knowing what they meant. So we were able, because this oral tradition is so strong, we were able to find out what these words meant. So the meaning has been returned to that very sacred thing. And I wouldn't actually put that sacred thing in a fantasy book because it's not fantasy. You know, it's my family heritage. But the importance of this oral tradition preserving the meaning, that I wanted to put in a fantasy book. So basically I did this by thinking of a story and saying this story had something similar happen to it. So yeah, really my biggest guidance is just my elders, the way I was raised to appreciate who I am.
That's awesome. Jordan, you were just saying something about incorporating diversity into like just the sheer amount of different types of cultures in your book. And I have to say, I was surprised by it too, because I opened it thinking, oh, cool, this is based on a Noah story from the motherland. Awesome, let me read it. And then I opened it and I was like, wait a second, there are so many countries in this. So I guess this question is for Megan. Raksha from Jasper High wants to know, how do you incorporate diversity into fantasy without feeling like you're having to meet like a quota or something? Because your book is very similar in that between the three countries and the little continent and all the countries that surround them, I see the little map in your background. there's so many different countries and the cultures are so diverse. How do you fold that in without feeling like, oh, I have to have this person and I have to have this culture and I have to, like, how do you...
When I changed Ray Bear to be specific instead of vague as a teenager in college, it was before there was any kind of push or wave for inclusion in the fantasy genre. And honestly, it just kind of, once I like let myself do a little bit, I kind of just went wild. I was just like, wait, I can put anyone in this book. So like, you know, and then back when I was young and full of hope, I thought this didn't seem like overkill at all until like I kept revising. And, you know, as I got older and also realized, you know, like you really need to represent these cultures with respect. I don't think I did it disrespectfully. I just like wrote and, you know, just like, oh yeah. And then this culture, I like those people. And I'd look at their clothes and like listen to some of their songs, like, yeah, sure. But then you gotta do so much more than that, right?
11 months of research. So,
exactly. And it was wonderful, but it was brutal. And I am never writing another story with 13 culturally distinct places. Even if I make them all up, that would be hard, right? That's just a lot to keep track, let alone like real places that I want to represent respectfully. And so like, yeah, I didn't feel any obligation. I wanted to very, very badly. It felt like a vacuum, like a switch had turned in my head of just like, I never have to write about another European country again. Like, that's something I actually have the power to do. So, yeah, I don't. And then, like, later, then I started hearing all these things about, like, oh, but isn't it too much pressure for diversity quotas? And I'm just like, this just seemed like the most natural thing in the world to me.
That's awesome.
My world has always had lots of different cultures and different kinds of people in it, even for the period that I lived in a really non-diverse place. My community had those people, and the media that I consumed was still very colorful, because there's obviously the West African stuff, but even within Nigeria in particular, like, Bollywood media is super popular. Anime was on the rise in the United States, especially among Black teenagers. I read somewhere that Black teenagers are, like, the highest consumers of Japanese anime in the United States. Like, it's just, there's always been, and all this is even without the clash of me being an American-born child of Nigerian immigrants who themselves grew up in a British colony and had a very British-influenced education. So I'd read all those books too. Like, it's just always been this melting pot. And so it was like breathing. What felt like not breathing was trying to write the fantasy that I had grown up reading and loving. But there was just something about it that would never feel like my heart, you know? And I will say that as an immigrant kid, if I'd tried to write like a completely West African story, that wouldn't have felt like me either, because that's not where I grew up. I'm the product of so many different influences. So for me, it wasn't something that I had to try and decide to do, or that I had any doubts about ceasing once I'd started, except with the amount of work I realized I'd gotten myself into. But I'm kind of stubborn even when things are like killing me. So I was like, I could take out some of these cultures, but no, I can have it all. I can have my cake and eat it too. So the community has been super kind. I think that I've received a lot of like graciousness and kindness, and so far I haven't like, you know, gotten something so egregiously wrong that, you know, someone had to write me a like stern letter. And honestly, if they did, I would be so grateful. Like, I really just need to know things. But yeah, I would say it was like breathing. And I hope that more people feel permission to write the world they live in, which is very colorful. And honestly, I think you have to be kind of conditioned to see it as otherwise. So that's what it felt like for me.
What about you, Megan? What did it feel like to write how diverse the world of the thief?
Well, let me just say that I'm, I think, significantly older than any of the other panelists. And that, wow, you think it was limited when you were growing up. when I was growing up, it was all Tolkien, or it was Tolkien knockoffs, or it was Narnia, which was lovely in some ways. Or, you know, I was thrilled with the work of Susan Cooper, The Dark is Rising books. But all of these are so very Eurocentric that I have a friend, Eve Sweetser, at the University of California at Berkeley, who has a theory that you can only read three books or three series based on Welsh mythology, and then it's all over. You'll never enjoy another one. and I really feel like you can read like three books set in pseudo medieval land. That sort of very vague, but definitely European fantasy world. And then you start to feel like that is the only way that you can have a fantasy world, is that sort of sword and sorcery. And those conventions get so strong that they're almost impossible to break. But I knew I didn't want to write a knockoff of Tolkien, partly because I never wanted somebody to come to Tolkien having read my book and think, oh, I've read this before. I'd much rather leave Tolkien there for the people to discover it than to write like a knockoff version of it that they would read instead. But I ran into this really tremendous difficulty, and that is that every place I had grown up looked like Middle Earth.
Mm.
So if I was gonna set a story in sort of my familiar landscape, it was gonna look like Middle Earth. And I really struggled with this. And I really wanted to find a different place to set a story. And I thought that was really important. But again, I didn't wanna spend 800 pages explaining an unfamiliar world to my reader. I wanted to get right into the story. So I wanted something that people could understand and sort of be familiar with and kind of recognize and yet have it be entirely unlike Middle Earth. And I struggled right up until like I got off the boat in Greece and I said, this is what I've been looking for. Mm-hmm. And I visited Greece in 1992 and I just connected with the landscape really strongly. And I realized that this is a landscape that because everybody is familiar with Greek work and, you know, because in the United States, everybody in either fifth grade or sixth grade has to learn Egyptian social studies class and Greek social studies class. And if they're lucky now, you have Chinese, you do a 6-week little stint on different cultures, and Greece is almost always one of them. And so I could count on my readers having some familiarity with what I was describing, but I knew that I didn't want to use the Greek gods. Mm-hmm. I wanted to have a pantheon, but I didn't feel at all comfortable just plucking the Greek gods out of their stories and reshaping them to suit my story, because I knew I didn't want to tell or retell a Greek story. I was going to tell something original. And I just really felt uncomfortable with the idea of refashioning those gods to suit my purposes. And so I decided I would try very hard to make up a fictional version that might feel somehow similar to how the Greeks felt about their gods. And then I dragged it all into the medieval Byzantine era because I didn't want it set in ancient Greece. So I think it's very interesting in what we feel like we can change when we're taking our world and turning it into fiction, and what we don't feel like we can change, or something, what we can touch and what we don't feel like we can touch. And I owe a great debt of gratitude to the writers that I did read, Diana Wynne Jones, for instance, who wrote 8 Days of Luke, which was a fantasy based on Norse mythology. And you may laugh, but I was like, whoa, that's really different. Who ever heard of like Norse gods? Well, back in 1975, it was a really big deal to have something that was not Welsh, mm-hmm. Saxon. And so I think that it's, I think when it came time to put together the world, I was relying a lot on the actual history of, all of that research. I'm very tempted to go reach over and get my Greece to 322 BC, which is like this thick. And it only makes it from ancient history to 322 BC. Jordan, I loved doing all of that research. But my problem was you had all of that information and not all of it could go into the book.
Yeah.
How do you cut out everything that you love and you think is super fascinating and your readers are going to be like, so that's a problem. There's always, I think, a tension between your desire to stick every historical thing that you know is true into your fiction, and you have to recognize that that's not going to help your fiction. And also that sometimes history sucks and it makes really terrible stories. And one of the great gifts that we have as fiction writers is, we can do anything in our book. if we want. We can put 9 different cultures in our book. You can see I'm getting excited and my hands become little. but yeah, when you're writing, you can put in your book what's important to you. Mm-hmm. And it's a thrill. It's a real thrill.
That's awesome. Actually, going off of that, putting in your book what's important to you, we have like 10 minutes. I have 3 questions that I really want to ask. So the first one is, Darcie, impact seems to be a massive feature of Alatsoe. I mean, specifically the displacement of Native American tribes. There are so many issues to address just when you look out the window and you think, God, we're in 2021, there's so much to talk about. You know, so many ways to try to fix this or that. How do you decide what's important to you to highlight in a book, especially when it's maybe a point of pain in your own culture?
Yeah, and that's a tricky one because I'm personally very private. So there's a lot of very painful things in my current and also, you know, historical family that I really don't want to touch upon because there is this thought that, you know, Native writers, they've got to write this tragic, basically, type of fiction. And that there's a place for that, but it's not what I want to write. But on the other hand, it's the reality we deal with. So in Alatsoe, there are themes like the bad guy's basically colonization personified. Like, let's just put that out there. He's got some other traits going on, but a large part is that how he and his group of scary weirdos and Willoughby basically come into Texas, displace this land, and in the process hurt a whole bunch of people, including, you know, Ellie's Native family. So it is a balance, and in my next book I actually focus a lot about how climate is going to change in Texas specifically, and this was before even this just terrible like winter kind of like pipes bursting and oh my gosh, so much of my family lost power. But it's almost like, so I do have to be selective because you can't put it all in one book, but I think about what is my character going through and how do maybe the issues of today or how are they impacting my character and how can I work this into a story that I enjoy writing, that's a way of me as a writer to escape, but also that I think readers will enjoy reading. Because like as a kid, it was really important to me when I was going through dark times just to have these fantasy books where the character in the end did succeed. I wanted there to be a kernel of hope in everything that I wrote. So that it is a balancing act sometimes, and I'm always working on it.
Awesome. My next question is for Hafsah. You have such a lyrical, visual, emotional, beautiful way of writing. There are some turns of phrase that if I flipped through it right now, you'd see like blue highlighter all over the pages. Because, you know, I'm one of those kids and adults who still, like, somebody says something and I will immediately take my phone and be like, I have to write that down, hold on. but what comes first for you, plot or that turn of phrase? Is that just a part of editing or is that just something that you immediately feel for a character?
So the writing is, yeah, that's something that comes first for me. World building is very close because I usually attribute both of those to being a designer, in which when I'm designing something, I'm taking a blank canvas and then trying to evoke as much emotion and as much of certain things, certain feelings with one piece of work, with one graphic design. And I think that translates into my writing where I'm like, I wanted to evoke that lush Arabian feel, that desert, that when you're sitting in the night in the middle of the desert at night and there's like smoke rising from a fire and people are telling stories around it and there's nothing but you and that story that's basically enveloping you completely. That was something I wanted to evoke when I was writing, and I think my natural writing state is that, because now that I'm writing a new story and this is a heist fantasy and it's grittier and there's a street urchins trying to destroy things, and it's just I'm having to like change my writing style, like conscious, like I just subconsciously write that way and then consciously have to come back and be like, oh, this is too much, this is, they're not princesses and princes, we're not having this lush story anymore, I've got to change things up. But I also think it's part of being from this culture in which storytelling is so important and such a big part of our lives. My parents are actually from Sri Lanka and ancestrally are from the Middle East. And in the Middle East, you have people are like, they live and breathe there. And it's just something that comes down, I guess, in your bloodline, where it's like everything that you do, you pay attention to the way you're saying it. It can be any simple story, but the way you say that story makes a big difference.
That's awesome. Last question, and then if we have time, we'll do a lightning round. Megan, you have some insane plot twists in this series. I mean, the kind of pitch the book across the room, flip back through the book, wait a minute, kind of plot twists. How do you go about creating and achieving those shocking reveals?
Well, I want to go back to what I said earlier about the power of convention. Mm. And, you know, for instance, the fact that that I did set my book in a sort of Mediterranean landscape, but with a sort of Byzantine level of technology, or, you know, pre-Renaissance level of technology. And yet, because I was writing a fantasy, and especially because I was writing a fantasy in 1996, the people were just stunned that there was a gun involved. You know, and I mentioned window glass, and I mentioned books and compasses and ships with cannons on them. And yet the convention that there are only swords in a fantasy novel is so strong that when handguns showed up, people were like, "Wait, no, this is a fantasy book. There are no rifle, no muskets in so." And in The Thief especially, I used that power of conventional thinking, and it, to my mind, I left clues like the size of billboards through, and as I was writing the book, I was like, nobody's gonna be surprised. Nobody, I mean, this signboards one after, no one is going to. And I was the one who was really surprised that other people were surprised. And
I have never guessed a Megan Whalen Turner twist ever. You get me every time.
I was screaming in bed. I was like, what?
So my goal is always to make sure that when there are two different kinds of twists in a book, I think. And one of them is where you're given all of the information and you're trying to figure out who done it. Mm. Right? And you're so you feel as if you're supposed to have figured it out by the time the big reveal happens. But the kind of book that I've wanted to write is one where you are given all of the information except the one vital piece. I like to set a book up like a string of dominoes. Mm. And then when the final domino is knocked, in retrospect, everything always looks different. I think it's unfortunate if people feel like they were supposed to see it coming. My only goal is to make sure that once it happens, you can go back. Ooh. And I have always said that I feel like my books aren't a success if I can't get people to read them twice. That people will read the book, they'll realize that everything that they just saw could be seen in a different light. And then they go back and they read it again, and hopefully they get as much pleasure from being in the know. And in that way, I think even if somebody spoils the book for you, hopefully, even if you know what's coming, you still enjoy reading it because you're giggling behind your hand because you know what the characters don't. Mm-hmm. But really, a lot of that just depends on writing conventions. And people get in a rut and they have expectations. And once you get them into that rut, you can pretty much count on them being carried by that rut, like right into a tree. They will just keep going down the avenue that the trope has laid out for them. I can only hope that when the trope takes them someplace else, they're happy about it.
Oh, that's awesome.
Okay. Though people do throw the book against the wall, it's true.
Lightning round. Few quick questions. So what we'll do is we'll go Darcie, Jordan, Hafsah, Megan, just because that's the order that y'all are in on my screen. So Sabrina from Griffin Middle School asks, any tactics for busting writer's block in like 5 words or less?
Yes, read stuff I enjoy, always, for me.
Jordan?
Do boring stuff. Let your mind get bored with no stimulation, and it will stimulate itself to do ideas.
Awesome. Hafsah?
Take a break. I think that helps all the time, especially when you're like so focused on your work.
Take a break. I like that. Megan?
I agree with all of those. Read, take a break. Jordan, I've already forgotten what yours was, but it was totally right. So fortunately, you all can go back and see the recording. But the other one I have to say is don't force it. You can almost always force your writing, even if you're blocked, and it won't be good writing.
Yeah.
So don't force it. It's okay to wait, and eventually the writing block will pass.
Okay, that's good. That's good. Okay, so Amy wants to know, what fantasy world other than your own would you love to live in? Darcie.
Oh my gosh, pass! there's so many. Oh my gosh. Maybe I'll think of it at the end. Somebody okay. else go.
Back to you. Jordan, you look like you're still thinking.
There are so many I'd live in if they were like versions that were kind of blacker and that I wouldn't stick out like a sore thumb. I guess mine, maybe by the end of this series when the Imperial stuff gets worked out, would probably be pretty great.
Asu, what about you?
I'd say Aralia too, but I think maybe the Shire just so I can have second breakfast.
There you go.
Again.
I think that I would go with Diana Wynne Jones' World of Crestomancy. Mm-hmm. Only, you know, she wrote Charmed Life and about 7 other books in that world. It's just, I'd like to be one of the magic users and not one of the people with no magic. So.
Darcie, did you
thought of it? All right, what's the name? Things we do in the shadow, what we do in the shadow, that vampire universe with yes! like werewolves, it's all comedy. I want to be a funny vampire, not like a sad, scary vampire. No, I want to be a werewolf. Okay.
Okay. Okay, I'm going to change my mind. I'm going with the werewolf world.
Let's be a pack. Oh, yeah.
We all have like our own Staten yeah. Island like vampire werewolf.
Yes. Amazing.
Okay, next question. Favorite writing snack? Like you're taking that break, Hafsah said take. What is your go-to writing snack? Darcie.
Belgian chocolates.
Ooh. Jordan.
Dried fruit. Mostly because we made sure that was what is in the house, because my writing snack is whatever's there at 2 a.m.
That's healthy. Unlike me, I prefer flaming hot Cheetos. There's okay. something about that just like gets my mind working. I guess it's because I can't think, it's so spicy.
Potato chips, unfortunately, is a big inspiration, you know. you go get the bag, you bring it back up at the desk, you just keep eating, and then you've eaten an entire bag of potato chips and you feel like you better write something now.
What about, okay, last question. Music while you work or no music? Darcie.
Generally no music, but I listen to like thunderstorm sounds that just like 10 hours of rains and thunder and ocean waves.
Awesome. Jordan?
Not while I'm writing. I'll get distracted, but before I write, or if there's a scene that I don't know how to envision, if I listen to any soundtrack, my mind just makes a scene to go with the soundtrack. Okay. So that's really helpful.
Very cool. Hafsah?
No music. I need silence to work with. But my sisters are always like in the same room as me. And so they sometimes play things, or sometimes I'll just turn to them to like discuss stuff. And so there's always some noise going on.
Megan, what about you?
I really like working in the cafe, which means that there's ambient music at the cafe. But I have to say, if I'm really working, I don't hear it. I don't hear anything, including, you know, people calling my name. So it doesn't really matter if there's music playing or not.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, guys, thank you so much for your time. All of these stories, if you haven't read them, I just mind blown. Love all of your books. They're so good. I am 2/3 of the way done with Return of the Thief, and that is the last one in a spree of 18 books, or 10 books in 18 days. So guys, just amazing job. Thank you so much for your time. And thank you so much for the effort that you put into your stories and the effort that you have of representation and touching on all of the things that, you know, make our hearts break about the world and still trying to fix them and show that there's hope anyway. Thank you so much. Y'all have a fantastic day.
Thank you so much for doing this, especially considering everything that's been happening with the power and the heat and everything else. I can't tell you how impressed I am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was fun.
Yeah.